Well, I'm here with Stuart Warren. Stuart, first time ever we fished together, which
first time.
Is kind of hard to believe.
Pretty amazing.
Yeah.
Working the river together for a while.
Yeah. So you just finished up a busy guide season on the Rogue. How you feeling?
Good. Tired, but solid season. Good fish return this year, I'd say. More big fish this year than I've seen in years past, which has been kind of exciting.
You must have caught all the big ones before I got down river.
Well, yeah, you know, when you put on at 9 in the morning, it's not hard to do.
You're putting on at 9 and still beating me down river, after saying. I like to start late and finish late. That's my strategy. And then they're like, wow, we're the only ones on the river today.
It works. It does work.
Yeah. There's only like 10 boats ahead of us, but we don't, you know, we never see them.
Well, we all rush through everything anyways, you know, so we don't ever fish it real well. So get first crack at it, kind of.
But not really.
Not really.
Oh, that's awesome. So let's get right to it. Today, so it's late November, kind of turning into that fringe season for us, where we've, on the Rogue, we're experiencing some higher flows and, you know, there's still fish trickling in, but not as many, or a little tougher to catch.
A little tougher to catch.
Kind of more like winter steelhead conditions, but we're fishing for summer steelhead.
Yep.
Other than the obvious, you change your strategy a little bit?
Yeah, start going a little deeper, of course. Start looking for those slower pieces of water, especially swinging flies.
Yeah, water that is maybe more akin to winter steelhead than, say, a summer steelhead.
Absolutely.
But it's all about water temps and water type, right?
That's right, especially this time of year. And like you said, water temps kind of control everything for us out here. So, you know, when that water drops, level and temperatures, you know, you got to start looking a little bit deeper, a little bit slower.
Yeah, fly speed is definitely critical. I was watching you fish earlier, and you were really fishing the hang down.
Absolutely.
Really focusing on the hang down. I get asked a lot when I'm guiding, how long should I leave it there? And I know, I'll let you take that one.
Oh, the hang down, it's one of those things we all as spey fishermen or guys swinging flies have a love-hate relationship with. You know, you get a lot of hookups or a lot of grabs in that hang down area, but getting those fish to stick a lot of times can be pretty tough. So,
yeah,
you know, how much time to let your fly swing through there is always, you know, it's a cast-by-cast, spot-by-spot basis for sure. But absolutely never let the hang down, you know, never don't fish the hang down. I always have my guys swing into that slow spot and let it just rest for a second. Sometimes, you know, when I got a lot, there's a lot of fish around and you just have that spot that you know there's fish in there. If it comes through that spot that you're waiting to get a grab it and nothing happens and it comes to that hang down, I'll have my guys once in a while just give it a little twitch just to get a little bit of flare at the end.
Mm-hmm.
And once in a while it works. So
yeah,
it seems like it's worth the time.
Yeah, for sure. For sure. Because you don't know if the fish followed it or the fish was just there, you know?
Yeah.
He was living, holding in your hang. You don't know. We don't know, right?
We don't know. Yep.
So if you cut them off early, fish that follows, then probably won't eat it.
Yeah. The most common mistake I see with that hang down is, you know, most guys are so excited to cast again, you know, and I think that's a real common, you know, mistake for most spey casters in general is we focus on casting so much that sometimes we forget we're fishing.
Yeah.
And so you get down to the bottom of the swing, you're getting excited, ready to make that next cast, and you just totally miss that last 10 feet of the swing. And so just calm down a little bit out there and let it swing into that soft spot and let it hang for just a minute.
Yeah, it's a tough, I mean, if you have a heavy fly and tip on, you might just hang right up in the rocks instead of hang down.
Yeah.
So like you said, it's a cast by cast basis.
Absolutely.
It's like trying to answer the question, how many times should I mend it, or how do I mend it, or, you know. Well, it just depends where you're at, right?
Depends where you're at, your cast, how you're fishing, what the fish are doing.
But you gotta let it hang. What other, so you look for softer water, deeper buckets. How about line systems? Winter steelhead setups versus summer. How much crosses over for you and what adjustments do you like to make?
Oh, this time of year, I like fishing those more full sinking heads. You know, right now I'm fishing Airflow's fist line. Great casting line. Picks up out of the water surprisingly well for it being, you know, almost a full sinker, which I like about it. And so this time of year, I start fishing, you know, T11 off the end of it. And then as we move more into that winter season and things get a little bit deeper, a little bit faster, I have a tendency to go a little deeper off the front, you know, some T14 or something along those lines. But
Putting more 8-weights in the arsenal.
That's right, yeah, stepping up the 7s and 8s, you know, a fast 7 or a little slower 8s. I like a little slower 8 in the boat once in a while.
Yeah, yeah. And there's always the debate, which always cracks me up, when someone says they got their first winter steelhead on the upper Rogue. And and then they, no, that's definitely was a summer fish, or, you know, does anyone care? I don't care.
I don't care either. You know, it, we like to talk about what we catch, which is, makes it, you know, kind of fun for sure. And, I've caught some fish already this year that I would make an argument that were winter fish, or if you want to call them late fall fish or whatever. But, you know, when you see fish moving through the system, then, you know, you catch some that are colored up. And in that same run, you come catch some that are real bright, real active, much more hard-finding fish, you know, kind of thinks, you know, leads you to believe that maybe some of those early winter fish are trickling in already.
Yeah. I mean, they cut it off, you know, they call it a summer or a winter, but, you know, what about the, is there a tweener run, you know?
Yeah.
So I often wonder about that. Some of those late fish we get in November, December.
Absolutely.
You know, when did they enter the freshwater?
And we're lucky here on the Rogue, you know, that we have both, you know, summer and winter fish. There's not a lot of rivers here on the West Coast that can really say that. They have like a real good healthy run like we do. So on the Rogue, I think there's a pretty good chance of finding a fresh fish, you know, 9 months out of the year. And I've caught a fresh fish every month out of the year on the Rogue. Now there's definitely months where I'm going to tell you that, you know, your luck is, you know, pretty slim to go out there and find one of those fish, but they do exist. So,
yeah,
you know, that's a one human condition that we have a problem with this as fly fishermen, I think, is that we apply human rules to fish that don't follow rules. You know, they don't read the rule book. They didn't get the email that morning. They're supposed to be in this spot that time of day.
Yeah.
So following the rules isn't necessarily a good thing as an angler, you know, mixing it up a little bit, trying new tactics. You know, if what you're doing right now is not working, switch it up, try something different. You know, whether it's a heavier fly, a bigger fly, maybe you need to go smaller fly, but just kind of, you know, moving with the flows, you know, and trying new stuff can be really productive for a lot of folks, especially when you start getting to that stuff like early summertime or, you know, like August, you know, fishing a dry fly here on the Rogue. You know, there's not a lot of guys that do that. So you can make a pretty good bet that no, not one of those fish has seen a single dry fly yet. And so that's a little bit new, something they haven't seen yet. And heck, it's exciting. And those fish will come get those bugs.
They will. And the Rogue doesn't, you know, it's not talked about like, say, the North Umpqua about being a dry fly river, but it works.
It works. Yeah, absolutely, it works. Yeah, sometimes I think that those fish prefer that dry fly, especially early in the season.
You tied me some flies this summer, and been fishing one today. I'm still waiting for it to work.
Yeah, me too.
But I see Quigley in some of your flies.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, he was a huge part of my my learning career, I would say. You know, Bob and I fished quite a bit when I first started working at the fly shop there about 10 years ago. We'd fish before I was had to be work at the shop, and I'd pick him up after I got off work at the shop, and we'd come right back out and fish some more. And then kind of in these in-between seasons, we spent a lot of time tying flies together. And so a lot of his knowledge and patterns and materials, especially the materials, is a real big part of my flies, you know, came from Quigley.
Yeah.
And that's something I'm pretty thankful to have. The main thing that really promoted Quigley's tying was that he's constantly changing his patterns based off of conditions or what he's running into fishing. And I find that with my own guiding, you know, that's really what, you know, when I go home at the end of the day and I need to tie some bugs, I'm tying stuff that I wish I would have had that day.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of what Quigley's flies were designed off of was that experience itself, is out there on the river, fishing constantly, having your you know, finger on the pulse and really understanding what's working. And, you know, not to say that steelhead are really fly specific. I think that there are times that they are more than others, for sure.
Yeah.
But, and that was always an argument that Bob and I had constantly, because, you know, as a professional fly tier, he had that belief that the fly is really everything, you know, it's gotta be just right. But, boy, if you look at the different patterns in a shop, how many different colors and flavors there are, you can't tell me that one fly works better than another. What really works better than anything else is you being on the river fishing that fly.
Yeah. I was offloading the boat today and you were joking around about being a client and helping out with the boat and whatever, and as a guide, you have your program and it's best if the customer just stays out of the way during that process. I forgot my anchor twice this year because a client kind of got it, distracted me and I got out of my routine and I forgot the anchor.
Yeah.
So in all fun, and it's all fun.
Yeah.
Do you have any client pet peeves you want to tell us about that won't get you in trouble?
Definitely the helping with the boat thing. I appreciate the help. I love the sentiment. I think it's great. But like you said, we get in a program out here and we do it every day. And we're pretty good at it at this point. But I find the most damage that happens in my boat, in my trailer, is when guys are helping me get it on and off. And it's all out of their good heart. I appreciate it. But that's definitely a pet peeve.
People want to help, of course.
Yep.
Yeah.
I got to say the next pet peeve, and probably my biggest pet peeve with guys, especially swinging flies, get a guy out into a run. You got two guys. All right, you go ahead and fish here. Wade out to about your knees or so. I'm going to take the other guy up top. So you're walking up river with your other guy and you look back around to make sure the other guy hasn't drowned yet. And you find him out there, standing up to his nipples, casting as far as he can. More often than not, I find fish in water that's knee deep to waist deep. So
yep.
If you wade way out there, you A, went right through where the fish probably were, and B, you missed them.
And you're hosing the guy above you.
And you're hosing the guy behind you too. So.
I think safety comes into play too, because the boat winch comes on clicked and it's under tension, and I've seen guys cut their hands on the boat winch.
Yeah.
I had a guy one year, I was dumping my jet boat into the lower rogue on a unimproved gravel ramp, and I was just about to push it off, and he jumped in from the other side to push it off, and his finger got kind of caught between the bow of the boat and that little rubber stopper. And as the bow of the boat slid off, it just took the meat right off his finger.
Oof.
Just gone. He didn't fish for a year after that.
Wow.
So,
yeah.
What's your plans for this winter?
Oh, boy. I'm going to be over on the coast a lot this winter.
Oh, good.
Fishing the Southern Oregon coast here. I'm going to work on developing a program that I feel comfortable booking with guests and getting them over there and trying to catch some big chrome fish.
Yeah.
So, my dad lives over in Brookings, so I'll be over there for good chunk of this winter, and then
nice
back here guiding a bunch of hope, and as long as the river gods don't blow us out again like last year.
Yeah, we've had a couple tough winters of a lot of high water, and that makes winter fishing challenging, but nice thing about the coast is there's several rivers that come into play early after a good rain, so that I always found that there was always something to fish. There wasn't many days I ever had to cancel over there.
Yeah,
so
exactly.
That's good. I know you're a passionate swing fisherman, and you can cast good, especially you got a good left hand. Oh, how long have you been working on your left hand?
8 years.
Okay.
Yeah, 8 years. I learned it at an early age.
Did you ever cack hand?
Oh, yeah. I still cack hand a bunch. If I'm going far on that river right-hand side, I'll go a cack-handed, snap tee, but... I had a good friend early on really dive in to spay casting with me, and he's a great caster. And he really forced me to learn that left hand. And I find more often than not, I use it a lot more than I think I would. There's just certain spots you get into, the North Umpqua or spaces here on the Rogue, where you can do an off shoulder, but you just don't get that same sweet casting direction or the right angle you're looking for. And so that left hand can really kind of come into play. And then who knows, maybe you fished hard all week and your right arm's just blown out. You're tired.
Yeah.
You can't cast with it anymore. So then you can switch to that left hand. So there's a lot of really good reasons to learn to cast both handed, or, amicastrous, as I like to call it.
Yep.
And, it just can keep that, that extra tool in the box when you need it.
Yeah. And I think it's intimidating to some people, but it's not as hard as you think.
No, it's not.
There's clinics I've done over the years. Say if we have 10 people in the class, you know, six might do it better cack hand and four might do it better with their left hand up.
Yep.
So it's something people I think should try.
Absolutely. And, you know, one tool I use for, you know, teaching the spay cast, especially with really good experienced single hand casters, you know, they have a tendency to really push that top hand when they're learning to spay cast. And so what I've done in the past with certain guys is make them learn left-handed, because it takes all that muscle memory out of the game. And yeah. I mean, it feels weird, but it felt weird to learn to spay cast from everybody on the first time. You know, you're getting to that different feel, two hands all of a sudden. So if you're really struggling with that right hand or that, you know, whatever dominant hand it is, pushing hard, switching to that off hand, really can take that push out of the game.
No doubt, no doubt. Left hand just doesn't know any better than to go with the program.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, Stuart, I'm stoked we got to finally fish together, and let's get back after it and see if we can get one.
Yeah, sounds good, John. Thanks.
All right, buddy. Thank you.